Blackstone Audio presents Race for the Dying by Stephen F. Havill. This book is read by Chris Andrew Ciulla. For Kathleen. 1. The sea reminded Thomas Parks of his father's neglected tea service. Had sunshine polished the waves and swells, they would have gleamed like lively pewter. But sky met Pacific gray on gray like a sheet of lead. Had there been a way to settle dust on the swells, the match with the pewter service would have been perfect. Thomas grasped the handrail along the slippery deck until his knuckles were white. Mist soaked his face, plastered his dark hair to his forehead, and found openings in his slicker, running under his woolen shirt to puddle behind his broad leather belt. It wasn't the gentle roll of the steam schooner that made him nervous. It was knowing that the coastline might be no more than a pistol shot off to starboard. He turned and glanced back toward the quarterdeck. The captain stood with another sailor, his pipe belching rhythmic plumes of smoke. A tussle-headed youngster tended the wheel with a serenity best reserved for sunshine, gentle breezes, and unlimited visibility. At any moment, a great black rock dripping with foam and kelp and seals would rise out of the sea, and they would never turn away in time. Thomas concentrated on the gray depth ahead, waiting for the first shadow, ready to vault free as the ship splintered and crashed under his feet. The Alice churned on without concern, without interruption of the captain's enjoyment of his pipe, without crashing into the rocks. At one point, Thomas heard the lethargic bell of a buoy come and go, but never saw it.
"We'll be docking within the hour,"
a voice behind him said, and he turned without releasing his grip on the handrail to see Newell Bassier's pleasant, lined face, water running down the creases and dripping from his gray whiskers.
"Thought you might want to fetch your gear,"
Bassier added.
"We're headed on up the coast and won't be stopping in Port McKinney long."
Able seaman, mate, bosun. Thomas had never understood the hierarchy of the ship's crew. Bassier appeared to spend most of his time carving spare belaying pins into elegant figurines.
"I have but the two bags," Thomas replied, "and they're ready and waiting."
"Ah, you travel a lot then."
"More is on the way," Thomas conceded. "Shipping overland, a mountain of things, believe me."
"Ah,"
Bassier said again.
"Well then, about an hour. The fog is lifting quickly enough."
"Quickly?"
Thomas said skeptically, and Bassier laughed.
"This is near a sunny day for these parts,"
he said.
"You'll get used to it. Look to the east there."
And he thrust his chin toward the bow. To the east was gray like everywhere else, but now Thomas could see a slender line, a color break above the waves.
"Enjoy the hour, doctor,"
Bassier turned.
"Shortly you'll be slogging through mud, soaked to the bone, and wishing for a warm bottle."
He seemed to be the only one on board who concerned himself, even in passing, with the needs of the passengers. Not that the three paying fares were high maintenance. One passenger, a priest whose name Thomas had never learned, kept to himself. But the third passenger, a short, florid man named Ephraim Carlyle, had bunked with Thomas, and his bulkhead-rending snores had been a wonder. On several occasions, the young physician had rested in the darkness, imagining each of the structures in the man's throat as they vibrated and roared to produce such an odd symphony, one that never awoke the composer, of course. An accountant by profession, Carlyle impressed Thomas as an odd duck. To hear him talk, Carlyle dealt with the intricacies of paperwork, but his hands were those of a bricklayer. Stubby fingers, cracked and broken nails, calluses that made his palms dry and hard. He looked no more the part of an office-bound cipher than did the salt-preserved captain of the Alice, Robert Kinsman. As his destination approached, Thomas forced himself to relax.
If the crew was not worried, why should he be? He contented himself with watching the constantly changing colors of the water as it broke around the bow. He could not pinpoint the time when they had turned eastward from their northerly route up the Pacific coast. The water told no secrets. From the time they rounded Cape Flattery.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.